Time for the fan favorite segment, the fan zone, where we give a focus on international football with regards to what is coming up next, the fixtures for the weekend and what happened in the midweek, the trending headlines as far as matters international football is concerned. It's the Touchline on Y254. My name is Maxwell Wasik, and of course joining me is, you know, Tiras Wayeke. How have you been, man?
I'm very well, excellent, nice and healthy, holy as ever, glad to be alive and kicking, and glad to be here.
How does it feel now that your product, you are a football coach, your product, Ayub Timbe, will be playing in the upcoming AFCON representing the country? How does it feel?
That's not guaranteed so far, because the final squad has not been named, not even the provisional squad for the tournament has been named. But Ayub had a leg surgery about a month or two ago, and he's been working to recover. And I've been following him on Instagram, I've been encouraging him. And I think he's very focused, just as he was when I coached him as an 11-year-old lad. And fingers crossed, Lord have mercy, I pray he makes the cut, and I hope he goes to the Cup of Nations in Egypt. And I want the world to see the metal of which that boy is made of. He's absolutely fantastic.
Absolutely fantastic, Ayub Timbe. Ian Wag also joining us, Chelsea Football Club supporter and, you know, a reputable hater of Mauricio Sarri, the social nerd, coming on the show after quite a while. How have you been, man?
No, I'm good, man. I'm healthy, too. Yeah, unfortunately, I don't have a star player I've coached, but yeah, I'm good, man.
But you're looking forward to having one soon.
Yeah, very soon, man. We're doing amazing things with the academy in Kisumu, so hopefully, yeah.
Hopefully. Steve Ayo?
Yeah.
Good to be back on the show.
I'll just need to back the trend, man. Healthy as well. Always a pleasure being here. You guys are doing an amazing job, and I mean, every opportunity I get to come here, it's always a pleasure.
Thanks, man, yeah, for coming through. Tira, starting with you, review of UEFA Champions League and Europa League matches happened in midweek, Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday. Which match did you watch yourself?
To be honest, I didn't watch any. Sorry to break your heart, but I sort of followed the highlights on YouTube rather carefully. What I was interested in is to analyze and sort of prepare myself for the predictions for what lies in store for this most decisive week we're going into, because that's when the return legs, or the second legs of the particular UEFA Champions League quarterfinal, are going to take place. So these particular matches coming up are more important than the ones that were on the week that's just been, but, or rather the earlier in this week. But having said so, both games are important because of the away goal factor. And obviously Barcelona scored an away goal, so they have an upper hand against United. Juventus scored an away goal, they have an upper hand against Ajax of Amsterdam. And those particular two matches are the ones that I really got interested in. I don't know why, but I think they have something promising in the second leg. That's why I got really interested in them.
How promising is the second leg, Ian Wanga, considering that Man United conceded at home and going into return leg? Of course, I've heard their fans saying that they can pull what they pulled on PSG, the French money bags. Is it possible?
To be honest with you, I know I'm a huge Barcelona supporter, but that was the most lackluster display I've seen of Barcelona in a while, and I feel like if there's a repeat of that performance, I'm seeing Man United going through, because if Man United were clinical in that game, they would have gotten two or three goals. You saw Barcelona were very poor, Messi was nowhere to be seen. So I firmly believe that Manchester United would be going to the Camp Nou very motivated. It's only one goal. If they score one goal, it's already even. So I feel like that the game is very open, and it's anyone can win it. And you saw what happened with Barcelona in Rome last year. So I'm really thinking Manchester United are in a better position than I thought they would be. So they might pull a surprise.
Cristiano Ronaldo was on the score sheet for Juventus against Ajax Amsterdam. I know in Turin it promises to be a mouth-watering clash, but Ajax Amsterdam are also not a walk in the park. They tried and give their best. What do you make of the return leg?
Ajax versus Juventus? Should be a crack of a match, just like the first leg really was. We've seen over the years, really, Ajax, they reached the Europa League final. where they lost to Manchester United and really no one was giving them a chance, and see where they are right now. They are, you know, just like Juventus, they have one leg in the semis, which pretty much just justifies the kind of work that, you know, the whole coaching department Ajax are doing. So you can't really write them off. Obviously, with Juventus, the moment you have a Cristiano Ronaldo in your side, you already have an advantage, and no player comes to the party more than Cristiano Ronaldo, especially in the knockout stages where we are right now. But the game is still open. It's 1-1. Ajax, really, they've been good this season. You can't really write them off, because Juventus, I think, the Serie A really for them is it's like
practice.
Yeah, practice, really. They win it. I don't know, this is going to be the 9th season in a row. Yeah, but when it comes to the Champions League, I think that's where Juventus need to show that they're one of the biggest clubs in the world. And with Cristiano Ronaldo in their ranks, I think you'll give them an edge when the return leg takes place in Turin.
I think with Ajax, Juventus is going to be pretty much a replay of AC Milan, Ajax of Amsterdam in 2003, when they really took one another out. Ajax played their hearts out in Ajax, the Amsterdam Arena, now known as the, what do you call this guy who played for Ajax, the Dutch master? Well, the Brunei Stadium.
No.
Way back in the 70s, he played for Ajax.
Johan
Cruyff. No prizes for guessing, but yes,
Johan Cruyff.
The renamed the stadium after him. And then they went to AC Milan San Siro Stadium, and every time AC Milan scored a goal, Ajax responded with a goal. So I think it's going to be cutting-edge football. Ajax lost to AC Milan that night because of the lack of experience. So it was in the dying minutes that AC Milan struck them, and there was no time to recover. 3-2. It was a thriller. You score, I score. You score, I score. Then, boom, the killer goal came on the third and last goal. AC Milan won it based on experience. And I tip Juventus to beat Ajax, not because they're better than them, but just based on experience.
And playing at home as well?
No, just experience. That's the key word.
Experience in terms of, because really if you look at experience in terms of winning the Champions League, then Ajax have it. They've won it three times, Juventus only once.
Experience on the current, current merit.
Yeah.
Not historical merit, but on current merit.
Okay.
But honestly, my feeling is, honestly, Ajax is the most exciting young team in Europe right now.
Mm,
so you see the players are playing with courage, they're very young players. So you saw what De Jong did in the midfield. Mm. They outpossessed Juve, they had more shots on target than Juve. So you really wonder, and they are such a young team. So and people are quick to forget that they once eliminated the defending champions.
Mm.
So I'm not writing Ajax off in any way.
And the comments from Max Allegri about the guy De Jong was positive.
Yes, very positive. That was a midfield masterclass, being that he's only 21 years of age. So I'm feeling this game will go to the wire. But the difference is Ajax don't have a Ronaldo.
that bit, yeah, it's just that edge,
yeah.
That edge in experience.
Yeah.
And Ajax may not have scored a goal if Chiellini was fit enough to play away at Ajax home stadium, because the absence of Chiellini meant that Juventus, in terms of defensive organization, were quite asleep. That gave Ajax so many chances. But if Chiellini was there, he would have just used experience to organize the lads and done very little work after that. It comes down to those kind of things of experience and organization. Chiellini's absence was felt. If he recovers from his calf injury, he may get to play and he may save Juventus. If he doesn't, then Ajax will capitalize on that, and it could be quite damaging.
I think for Ajax, really, it's a case of the whole better being better than the sum of its parts, because you know, for them, they play as a unit.
Yes.
Just like we were saying, it's a very young, exciting squad, which is quite unfortunate for them, because I'm sure at the moment this season is finished, two, three, four players
will have to
leave Ajax, you know, and somebody else will have to come in. And now that's the problem with Ajax, you know, it's like they have this inflow and outflow kind of thing, so that, you know, players never really stagnate at some point in time, which pretty much works against them, because the moment you think that they are making progress as far as, you know, the club is concerned, because it's pretty much one of the biggest clubs in Europe, historically and even as we speak right now. So for them, I think so far, where they've gone so far, given the age of those players, I think they've been they've done pretty well.
Yeah.
And if they can go past Juventus, then I think they would have deserved it. But as far as that game is concerned, they just have to go as a collective because, they don't, as we've said, they don't have a Cristiano Ronaldo.
For many years, let's talk about academy. That clash. They had the best academy.
They had the best
Europe.
Academy.
And they've stuck there. They like to produce talent.
Yeah.
But the environment has changed. You produce... Your product is bought,
yeah.
So they have to invest in keeping these guys if they want to conquer Europe.
Yeah.
Otherwise, they'll be producing, and their products are bought.
Liverpool against Porto, your team winning.
Yes, yes.
That was expected.
Course. Yeah, of course, man. Of course.
Or VAR worked in your favor.
I don't think that was a penalty.
Just referred to it as robotic.
I don't think that was a penalty because if you look at the movement of Trent Alexander-Arnold, who, you know, the goalkeeper, Alisson, kicked the ball on his hands. I think he had his back turned against that ball, so it would have been unfair. But as far as that tie is concerned, I don't think there was really an upset. We expected Liverpool doing that much, given that the fact that last season they met and they beat Ajax, Porto 5-0 away, and this was at Anfield. So 2-0 really, we felt like it was really
substantial.
Yeah, substandard performance. The likes of Salah, Mane, they weren't so clinical in the attack. The return leg, obviously, 2-0 in Europe, you can't really say you've won it. You know, we saw what happened last season. So the tie is still open, but obviously you have to say Liverpool are the favorites to go through.
Spurs against Manchester City, English Premier League derby. Spurs winning at home at their new stadium. Can they maintain the same focus getting into the return league so that they can advance to the next stage despite having been written off when the draw was conducted?
I think I was one to one, and I think you're even present when someone was saying City will go through. And I don't know why people have never accepted the fact that Pochettino is a tactical genius. The guy came, he set up a squad against a very strong City side, he's able to win it, and Spurs might go on, because I'm thinking all they need to do is defend the lead, and they defended for 90 minutes, City didn't get a clear-cut opportunity. So I'm thinking, just like the Liverpool game last season, anything can happen away in the Champions League. So I think Spurs can be able to eliminate City.
Sure. Yes. And we're going to speak about Thursday night football as well. Both Arsenal and Chelsea won. Arsenal against Napoli. Wow. Carlo Ancelotti, despite that fantastic record he has against Arsenal when he was in charge of Bayern Munich, couldn't replicate the same.
I expected Napoli to beat Arsenal, to be honest. No disrespect to Arsenal. They get a lot of flack, but I really did expect that. However, football is not mathematical. I think we've just learned that from the first session of this show. It's about what you put in on that particular night and what you've put in terms of your training physically and mentally towards that match. I don't know now what chance Napoli stand, because 2-0 is quite considerable. And to overturn that, you've got to work extremely hard against a side that's also determined to work extremely hard for perhaps their only realistic silverware for this season and for the longest time possible, after having last won the FA Cup, I think, two odd seasons ago, Arsenal. But you really don't count the FA Cup, prestigious as it is, and compare it with conquering Europe. So in terms of Europe, this is quite something for them. And now that they are a shoo-in to the semi-final, I think Arsenal are pretty much, they're quite there. But I've seen games overturned in the second leg of the European wrestling matches in terms of football action. And I still tip Arsenal. I'm not a betting guy, but were I to bet, I'd put a shilling on Arsenal.
You just have to look at the manager who's in charge of Arsenal, Unai Emery.
Yes.
And you saw the kind of work he did with Sevilla as far as, you know, their Europa League campaign was concerned.
Yeah.
Was it three titles in 4 years?
Yeah.
Yeah. So I think for him, he's a master of winning the Europa League. And you have to see the way Arsenal actually, against Rennes, we saw what happened. They were trailing, was it 3-1?
From
the first leg, yeah. They went away, turned the result around. And I think there was another game, was it during the group stages also, where they needed to win? So I think for me, you have to look at the kind of results that Arsenal have been able to pull off so far, and given the circumstances under which they have, and you have to tip Arsenal to be one of the favorites, and also given the fact that you know, the Premier League, the race for the top four, which guarantees Champions League football next season, it's really, really tight. Yeah. So for Arsenal and Chelsea, this is another opportunity for them, basically, just to, you know, you win that title and you can finish sixth or even seventh in the Premier League, and you're
and
in the Champions
League. And talking about Chelsea,
season.
He supports Chelsea, but he's ahead of Mauricio Sarri. Did you get your tactics right against Slavia Prague? Of course, Marcos Alonso scoring during the dying minutes of that particular game. But what do you assess of his tactics so far, despite your unwavering hate for him?
I'm really confused about Mauricio Sarri, because first of all, that was the worst game we've played in weeks. We've had a run where we fielded our young players, we've been playing exciting football. You've seen what Eden Hazard has been able to produce over the last few weeks. Then suddenly you just go down. So there's kind of an instability about him that really baffles me. Because one time we are playing at this level, the next time we are playing at this level. And the game against Slavia Prague is a perfect example. Because that was, honestly, that was just awful. It was an awful performance. Even the fact that he rotated the squad might be the reason why. Mm-hmm. But it also shows, I think the ownership of Chelsea should now see what kind of players we are buying, because we have players who don't deserve to play for us anymore. People should play for mid-table teams.
Like who?
Like Mateo Kovacic, my God. Mateo Kovacic was awful in that game. Marcos Alonso, despite scoring the goal, he was awful. Willian is past his good days, man. He's now finished.
So you're trying to insinuate that there has to be mass exodus from Stamford
Bridge? Is it really about maybe some of these players, probably they've regressed since Sarri came in, the likes of Willian? Last season, I think even Barcelona wanted him. Marcos Alonso, last season, assists everywhere, you know, all those crosses and... I don't think the players really...
No, I get it. But shouldn't a player be able to adapt to a system? Because, I mean, we've played already over 40 games in a season. Mm-hmm. Eh? So maybe it's the tactics of the coach. That's why I'm not for Mauricio Sarri. But that being said, the players who just can't adapt to this new way of football. Mm-hmm. And I think regardless of the kind of manager we bring in, we have to get quality players. You look at our midfield these days and compare to our midfield maybe in 09-10 season, and you wonder what went wrong. We are playing the best DMF in the world in the wrong position. Mm-hmm. We have one of the best wingers in the world, but now the supporting cast, we don't have a striker. We have very amazing talent in the bench, but we can't really seem to give them opportunities to start.
Yeah.
But what I'm happy about is right now Chelsea, we have some amazing talent in the Championship, in our bench. You see Loftus-Cheek, you see Hudson-Odoi. Yeah. We have very amazing players. We have Andreas Christensen. We have Rhys James in the Championship. I was just put in the Championship Team of the Year with Wigan. So I'm thinking when we change the management, we are going to be an amazing team.
Away from European football, with regards to the fixtures that happened in midweek, to something that also happened last weekend, Atletico Madrid against Barcelona. That game saw witnessed a scenario where Diego Costa, former Chelsea striker, was sent off following his crude remarks against the mother to a referee who was officiating the game. How crude is Diego Costa?
And he also,
despite the talent,
he also handled the referee physically. So he gets
8-match ban, deserving.
He gets
too huge.
He gets a 4-match ban for the insults alleged, and then 4-match ban, another 4-match for physically manhandling the ref. So that's 8 matches in total.
Yeah.
You may think that's a lot, but I think when you look at the circumstances, he deserves it. But the fault is not Costa's. The fault is the club that signed Costa. When you sign Costa, he comes as a package.
Yeah.
Costa doesn't come alone.
Yeah.
He comes with his menacing ways. And even that's why he left Chelsea. The day and age when you encourage that sort of signing is gone. That belonged in the 90s when there was no internet. And so you relied on your scouts for buying players, you relied on videos that you were given, so this could be edited, and they would leave out the filthy parts, and you relied on word of mouth. pretty much, maybe from your friend or something like that. But now you have so much information, thanks to the internet, you know pretty much everything about him, him, myself, and yourself. And we are not even celebrities as such. But just get on the internet, you'll find out about us, pretty much. When you sent me, we're going to be with a guy called Ian Waga, I looked him up on Facebook, and he was there. Look, I mean, there's so much information.
And you followed each other on Twitter as well.
Do we?
Yeah.
I didn't know, but I checked him up on Facebook. I mean, this is this is just so much, you see? Yeah. So there's no excuse for a club signing such a guy. Get on the internet, you can choose to buy players from Africa. Africa is teeming with talent. Go to the streets of Yaounde. Don't even go to a stadium. Just go to the streets of Yaounde. Where do you think Real Madrid picked up Samuel Eto'o from? They picked him up from the streets of Yaounde in Cameroon, the capital of Cameroon. Go anywhere. Go to Europe. Go to Latin America. Sign talent. You don't have to sign a rude boy anymore. Those days are gone.
Yeah, to an extent, to an extent.
But several players who've been spectacular, talented, there is some sort of rudeness associated with them. Zlatan Ibrahimovic,
like
Diego
said,
Costa.
Like you said, there are
bad
players
boys
who,
of football.
Yeah, there are players who, when you sign them, they come with, he said, a package. But the likes of Diego, you can't call it a package. It's a baggage. <You know? laughs> Balotelli, same kind of a player. Luis Suarez, same kind of a player. I think some of these players really, some of these clubs, they don't have that patience. Because, I mean, look at Atletico Madrid. Look at the kind of strikers who've come out of that club. The likes of Diego Forlán, the likes of Antoine Griezmann right now, Fernando Torres. Even Diego Costa, when he left Atletico, went to Chelsea. He actually is the one who actually helped Chelsea win the...
Sergio Aguero.
Yeah, Sergio Aguero and all that. So Atletico always have this knack of, you know, identifying these top, you know, marksmen or strikers for that matter. And Diego Costa is one of them. I know he brings a lot of baggage with him, a lot of indiscipline, but for me, if I were to, would I rather sign Diego Costa or I go to the streets of Africa and look for somebody who I'll probably need to be patient 4 or 5 years, you know, football, there's really not that much patience these days. So yeah, I'm for development, all right, but if Diego Costa is available, you just need to find somebody who'll handle him. And, you know, he can be banned, he can get banned for 8 matches, just like Suarez was banned during the incident with Patrice Evra, but see what he did once he came off from the suspension.
Talking from Chelsea FC perspective, Diego Costa prominently featured for you before. Can he trained? Can he get a disciplinary tactician who can change his behavior? Because we've had such managers who can stamp authority. Sir Alex Ferguson used to be of that nature. Can Diego Simeone replicate, emulate on what other coaches have done in terms of, you know, molding him to become something vicious?
I think, to be fair to Simeone, I think he has tried. Because I don't think there's nothing Simeone has not told this person. But now, there are moments of madness that sees Diego Costa just lose it. And you saw it in during our time in Chelsea, when he was happy, he was healthy, he was scoring lots of goals. We didn't have any issues with him. He was amazing. He won us 2 Premier League titles. Mm-hmm. He was a very good striker. But now he has moments of madness that I think are in his character, and I don't think that can be changed, especially at his age now. Were it a younger player, we would have said not really. But now he's almost, I think he's way past his 30s now. He's almost 30.
He's probably turning 32 this year.
Yeah.
If he hasn't already.
Yes. So he is a
good
striker.
Age, I think he's 27.
So he's
I remember when he was at Chelsea, he was almost 25.
Yeah, 24, 25. Yeah.
So regardless of the age.
It's like Balotelli. You can't change Balotelli.
Yeah, you can't.
And now English Premier League coming to an end, and there is this talk of PFA, Professional Footballers Association, players of the season, probable nominees and subsequent, you know, ultimate winner. Who has been standout players for you this particular season, overall in English Premier League football?
I'll nominate 3. One, whom I know will not win it, but he's worth the nomination, Declan Rice of West Ham United.
Sure!
Oh yes, that boy has been an absolute revelation. He has got the typical traditional working class culture in him. He works hard, he gives it his all. when you go down the pub to watch him, you don't feel like you've wasted time, because sometimes you go down the pub to watch footballers and they don't give their all. Yeah, they are paid so much money.
He might win the Young Player of the Year.
But he might win the Young
Player. He'll definitely get a nomination.
Yeah, so he's one guy who's been absolutely fantastic. Mm-hmm. He's been called to play for England. I'm glad for him. And he's a young lad. I like that. The other two nominees, Paul Pogba, because he's not a striker. I'm against strikers winning this thing, and they keep on winning it until football has been belittled to goal scorers. And who else? De Gea, the goalkeeper for Manchester United.
It's been rumored that Manchester United won Declan Rice. So,
United. Steve, what are your nominees?
I'll go for Son. I know he won't win it. Son Heung-min of Tottenham. I think he's one of those unsung heroes in the English Premier League. One of those players who...
So underrated?
It is extremely underrated, that player. They talk about Kane and they talk about Ali and all those English-based players. But the player who makes things tick at Tottenham for me, it's Son.
Yeah.
He's an amazing, amazing talent. The two that I'm sure will make the top two and will probably win it is Raheem Sterling of Manchester City. Absolutely fantastic player this season. Be it in the Premier League,
even international football.
International football, wherever he's touched the ball these days, he's made that ball sing to his tune. And obviously you can't think beyond the best defender probably in the world right now, Virgil van Dijk of Liverpool. The two of them, Sterling and Van Dijk, whoever wins the Premier League this season, I think one of either will be the PFA Player of the Year.
Okay, I'll have to back the trend. The one who probably won't win it and who is arguably the best talent in the Premier League. Mm-hmm. So Eden Hazard, of course, man, phenomenal again, man. He does things that you just dream about, things only few players can be able to do.
Mm-hmm.
So the other two, I'm with him. It's either Virgil van Dijk or Raheem Sterling.
Sadio Mane is not making the list.
He's a late bloomer.
Despite his late exploits this season.
He's a late bloomer. He'll be in the top five. Yeah, he'll be in the top definitely. Five, definitely. He'll be in the top five. But as far as I think the player who's made a lot of impact for Liverpool this season, obviously the goals have been coming from Firmino and Salah has been, Mane has been really the go-to guy, especially as far as this year is concerned. But if you are to put Mane and Van Dijk and say, pick for me one guy.
None of them is naming a goalkeeper. And you're not shouting them down.
also the reason Sterling is winning it is also his off-pitch things that he's been doing.
Yeah, racial discrimination.
So that's larger than football. Sure. So I think hands down he should win it, regardless of if they win the league or not.
Yeah.
And now talking about the English Premier League football, Kenyan football fans have something to be proud of. Victor Wanyama has just scored for Tottenham Hotspurs against Huddersfield. 24th minute, Spurs leading by 1-0. And other fixtures, of course, slated for this particular afternoon. Brighton play host to Bournemouth, Burnley against Cardiff, Fulham against Everton, Southampton against Wolverhampton Wanderers, then Man United late fixture against West Ham at 7:30 p.m. Then tomorrow, the pulsating clash of the weekend, Super Liverpool Sunday. Against Super Chelsea. Sunday, yes. Is that a determining factor to who wins the English Premier League title?
Definitely.
Yeah. For Liverpool, really, only five games remain. So for them, it's always said, every game is a final. But that's the fact for them. And you remember what happened 5 years ago with Chelsea and Liverpool.
And
it was pretty much around this time of the season. So, man, there are butterflies in my stomach. But luckily, there's no Demba Ba. So some things won't happen. But I always disagree with people when they say that Liverpool lost the title at that point in time. For me, it was that 3-3 draw with Crystal Palace. That's where Liverpool lost it. The game with Chelsea tomorrow, it's coming at such a definitive time of the season. Liverpool definitely have to win that match and just keep on putting the pressure on Manchester City, who have a game in hand. You know, that game in hand will always play in the back of both Jurgen Klopp and Pep Guardiola. So they just have to do their job, because I think earlier Man City will play Crystal Palace, so depending on the result there, Man City could go on top. If Liverpool don't beat Chelsea, they'll be second, and you know, pressure, man.
But you've seen, especially Eden Hazard, he enjoys playing against Liverpool.
He does.
So it's going to
I hope he picked an injury in training.
I think it's going to be a draw, to be honest.
Honestly, that's my opinion.
I think why do you think it's going to be a draw?
Liverpool are chasing silverware, so they're chasing the title.
Yeah. As they're chasing Europe.
And these guys are chasing Europe.
Yeah.
I mean, neither side can afford to lose.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And at the same time, one of the two sides cannot afford to win at the expense of the other.
Yeah.
So I'm seeing a draw. In as much as they'll be both going for glory, they'll also be cautious at the back.
Mm-hmm. Very cautious.
So, yes, I'm seeing a draw.
Hopefully Liverpool. The men playing at Anfield at the Kop end, they can suck in some goals, you know, in the second half especially, because I think for Liverpool it's a bigger match for them because you know we all know how long they've waited for this title. So it's just a case of now them expressing themselves, playing with a lot of emotion, enjoying themselves on the pitch because they are at Anfield where they've not lost for almost 2 years now. So they have to turn that perceived draw into a win, but like he says, you know, even Chelsea need a win in this match. So for Liverpool, they can only hope that the Chelsea that turned up against Slavia Prague is the one that will come at Anfield.
Ahmed is cracking some joke. The first African to squad the Tottenham Hotspur Stadium is Victor Wanyama. Good build up ahead of AFCON. As he seeks, you know, even cementing his place in the national team, considering there has been much speculation over, you know, his captaincy.
Yeah, he's not had a good season with Tottenham due to the injuries he's sustained this season. You know, he's been in and out of the treatment table, which really, for a player of Wanyama's caliber and age, really, it's not good to be always on the treatment table.
Rumors online all over about his age.
Yeah, we'll just let him enjoy his game. You know, for as long as Wanyama is there, we'll always keep supporting him, and that's good history. Really, the first African to score, and I'm actually even happy the first a player to score a competitive match. Leave alone the, I think they played under 20, and there's some youngsters who scored. The one who scored there was a South Korean Son. Yeah, the guy who says underrated.
That's a
so
good thing.
It's good.
His brother, or is it step brother? It was the first East African to win the UEFA Champions League.
Yeah.
And
McDonald
Mariga. Are they stepbrothers or brothers?
They're brothers.
Same mom, same dad?
Yeah.
Yes.
Blood brothers.
Yeah. Brilliant. Yeah.
Anyway, as we wind up, the draw for African Cup of Nations was conducted last night in Cairo. Kenya is in Pool C. Mm-hmm. What do you make of their chances? As talking from perspective of a football coach.
In terms of talent, maybe the previous team of the Titus Mulama who was sat here was more talented. But in terms of technical prowess, I think this team is better. And I think at times it comes down to technical prowess. If we support them materially, and there's been a lot of talk that they have been supported financially, mm-hmm. if we support them also mentally, in terms of having supporters on the ground there in North Africa, in Egypt to be precise, supporting them. Because normally in the past we have sent contingents there and no one to support them. You need a 12th man. If you don't have that 12th man, you're just playing Rohoju. You need that support. When you see your flag flying there in the stands and guys speaking your language, Nelson Mandela said, someone who speaks your language speaks to your heart.
Mm. Yeah.
So we need, if we can organize, and I don't know who can do that. I think you can do that. We leave that to you. Take some Kenyans there, 200 Kenyans or whatever, and have them supporting these guys. This team can make the cut to the quarterfinal, I am sure.
What's your take?
It's a football game. Everyone has a chance, but honestly, our chances are very slim. Senegal, first of all, are the highest ranked African team in the world.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't see us picking a result there against the kind of talent they have. But against Algeria, I'm very optimistic, and my reasoning is especially the games we've seen, the way when Gor Mahia played top Algerian sides, and you've seen how the matches have been, especially at home. So I'm thinking if we employ the same tactics, and I was very, very proud of our team when we went to Ghana last time, because we went there with a plan.
Yeah.
You could see the tactics, you could see what the coach was doing. So I'm very happy this time we have a coach who has maintained some kind of squad. He has players he must improve, so they've kind of gelled together, and the tactics seems to be working somehow because we are there, you see. So I'm very optimistic this time around. We have not been hiring and sacking coaches. I think this is the coach we've had for at least quite a while.
Yeah.
And it shows where the problem in our football is.
Mm.
The change of management has been really affecting us. And this coach actually seems to know what he's doing. So I won't write us off. I'm very happy that we have our top players, the Olungas, and my personal favorite, Eric Johanna, will be there playing. So I'm very happy for the team. Whichever result we get, we'll be supporting the team.
Steve, I know you've covered these boys most times while featuring in Kenyan Premier League, National Super League as well. Good squad. Getting into the Continental Shop is in a few months from now as we speak.
Yeah, I think this is pretty much the first time in a long time that you can ask somebody who knows anything around football, and they can actually tell you a Kenyan first 11 that it's close to what probably Mini will go to Egypt with. Yeah, and I think you have to give credit to, I think there are two things that have changed for Kenya recently. It's the leadership and the system. The leadership in terms of, you know, who are the administrators of the game, and also the system in terms of how our players treated. And, you know, going to Egypt, there's more incentive than just them going to enjoy themselves. There's money, man. That's going to be a big factor. I've seen big figures, 250,000, what. I'm telling you now, the competition in the Kenyan Premier League, the next few months is going to be crazy, because every player wants to get that money, because it can change your life. So that money itself, the incentive itself, I think is going to probably push these stars to a great level. And this team is exciting, let's be honest. I think it's one of the best teams we've had in a couple of years. The system is working. If you just look at the defense, the competition is out of this world. The midfield as well, they're attacking. There's just too much for this team. As in, I'm speechless.
Considering the economic crunch, I think with the incentives that have been promised by the government towards the players, I think I'm going to get in touch with a few of my players in the national team, Patrick Matasi and Paul Were, so that, you know, they can rescue me from this.
I'll get in touch with them.
And Ronald O'Court, if he makes the cut.
It's back at Sofa Court. Because it's been the touchline on Y254 every Saturday, 1 to 3, we're doing this. And gentlemen, thanks for coming through. Taylor Zwayaki, a football coach, he says that he has his boys playing overseas and wishing him the best. Ian Waga also has a good academy set up in Kisumu. How is it doing, by the way?
No, we are currently in the teething phase, so we are just starting it. So yeah, it's amazing so far.
Wishing you the best. And Steve, you are a reputable football analyst and writer as well.
Also joining us. An academy myself.
What is its name?
Myself.
Yourself.
Thanks for tuning in.
Let's do this again, sir. Next Saturday, same time, same place. And always a pleasure having you on board. Let's continue with the conversation at Wasike Maxwell, at Osoro Bats. #TouchlineY254. Salute and have a fantastic weekend. Enjoy and God bless you.